12 months to really try and change how search works on mobile in particular. And app indexing really forms the bedrock of what we're doing. I'm going to spend most of the time talking about app indexing. I'll talk a little bit about Now API, which is a bit about Google Now, and what we're trying to do to enable developers and partners to integrate into Google Now. And then Amrita will talk a bit about how people are actually starting to engage and search in different ways around voice actions. So app indexing. So the basis of app indexing is really simple. As Amrita outlined, more and more people are using apps. From Google's perspective, we obviously had different perspectives on the way that we thought the world would go, but we recognise apps are absolutely critical for users. So in that spirit, what we're doing is we're enabling users, when they're searching through Google, to essentially be able to link to app results in the same way we would link to the mobile web. And we're enabling, and for developers, this is great. This is a great opportunity to drive re-engagement and resolve one of the critical problems. So here's an example of how we provide deep links in search from search into apps. In this example, I've searched for a hotel in Singapore, place to stay. I have two apps installed on my phone, a TripAdvisor app and a Guardian app, and there's two of the search results that enable me to deep link directly into the app. Here, I click on the TripAdvisor link, and it instantly opens the TripAdvisor app. So as developers, you're essentially saying to us, we think that the app result, you know, our app page is the most relevant for our users, and we're providing that to users. So re-engagement's great. Amrita mentioned earlier, 3/4 of the apps on people's phones are rarely used, 1/4 never used at all. So this is what we're trying to wrestle with. We're trying to provide that relevant, useful information to users and get them access to it as quickly as possible. But there's a second challenge here, and one of the reasons we wanted to speak to you today, which is about installs. So how do we actually enable users to find relevant information if they haven't installed your app? So we also announced earlier this year that we can enable users to install your app if they don't have it installed and it's relevant content. So if you've implemented app indexing and we understand your content, when a user makes a search, we can provide a recommendation if there's relevant content in your app. We can recommend to them that they download your app and shift that user directly into your app. So in this example, I'm searching for inspirational public speaking quotes, and there's a recommended page within the Pinterest app. I have a carousel, which we're increasingly seeing in search, where there's different recommended options. I can click to install, it'll take me to the Play Store, download it, and then directly into the app. This is obviously great to drive installs, but it's also great because it's driving installs at a point of need where a user's actually got a specific query that's particularly relevant. And I've got some data I can share where discovering apps and downloading apps through search is a really, really compelling way for users to engage with your apps straight off the bat. So the final part here is, the same with search, there's one final part to app indexing, which is about driving auto-completions. So in the same way that you might search, type a query into Google Search, we provide recommended search queries based on what you've typed previously. We do the same for app indexing. We provide recommended auto-completions that, again, if they're clicked on by the user, will deep link directly into your app. This is just another way to drive re-engagement, to get people coming back to your apps, to get people coming back to your content. So in this example, this is a Live Nation app. I'm a particularly big fan of Kenny Chesney, and if I type in Kenny, I get some recommended pages for Kenny and his upcoming stores in Live Nation. And one final, very important reason why this should be interesting to you if you have an app, this is actually a signal in search. You're essentially saying to us, this is content that is mobile, we call it mobile friendly in our eyes, this is the most relevant content for our users in our app, and we take that as a signal in search. So if you've completed app indexing and indexing of your app through deep links, and if you've completed the API integration, those are two signals that we will take to consider that your content is mobile friendly and relevant for you. Okay. So as I mentioned earlier, so we probably got started on app indexing in earnest about 18 months ago, and we're just starting to be able to share some numbers. We have a few case studies that I can talk to search engines, it has real resonance. A third of people actually do discover apps with search engines, and a further third are more likely to download when suggested than organic listening. As Amrita outlined, this is our core competence at Google, linking users to information. And it's what we're great at, and we see very, very good results from our partners who've integrated today. Here are just some examples. So we have Etsy, The Guardian, and Yellow Pages also are seeing increases in traffic to their app. There's different variations, but 12% with Etsy. We have Guardian seeing almost 5 percentage points increase in people coming to their app through the app links than the mobile web. One of the reasons for that is in the earlier user, the way in which we've designed the links into apps is we have very prominently shown the app's brands. We have a significantly large amount of text as well, and we see an increase in the number of users who click on those links. Finally, we have Yellow Pages who've seen an increase in traffic by 8%. But we also see more engaged users. So we find that users in the Daily Mail in the UK are spending more time in the app. They're more likely to share content if they've discovered that app through search. They're more likely to read more content. They're more likely to view a video. Overall, impressions are going up, but I think that's also one of the key points that we're seeing come through is we have more engaged users as well. And finally, in Tableau, they've seen an increase in people coming to the app, but over time they've also increased the amount of their app that's deep linked. So one of the key things that we wanted to do with app indexing is enable developers to index a portion of their app, and then over time they can add more and more deep links, and that makes sense, tracking the metrics as they go. So we've made good progress. We have hundreds of partners who are live, many in APAC as well. And one of the reasons now we wanted to come and reach out to all the developers is to continue to help to drive that adoption. We've got most of the largest partners in the region, and we continue to see many, many new apps deep linking as well over time. So next steps. Firstly, we have a huge amount of information available in our developer docs. We have videos, we have step-by-step guides of what needs to be done to implement app indexing and deep link your app. At a basic, you need to enable app indexing in your mobile app. You need to prepare your website and what content that corresponds to in your app and deep link to it. And then you need to verify your setup. Finally, we provide weekly reports and metrics to you that show how many impressions you have, how many click-throughs, so that you can track the impact it's having to your app over time. You can choose how to expand your deep links over time and actually measure the impact for you. And then finally, starting to recapping on I/O, one of the announcements we made was regarding Now on Tap. So this is looking to the future. If you complete app indexing, it makes you a candidate for Now on Tap. For those who didn't watch the I/O keynote, this is essentially, we're starting to try to understand the context around how people are interacting and what people are doing. In this example, we understand the context through a message chat about a restaurant reservation. If you press the home button, it will then launch Now on Tap, which understands the context and then makes a recommendation of apps to open. Here, there's the Open Table app. It understands that they're talking about Reposado, which is a restaurant. Press Now on Tap. It understands the context of that conversation and provides Open Table as an app to open. You can then click on that link and it will deep link opening the app directly to a booking. So this is a great example of another way in which we're thinking about how do we enable users to find content that's in your apps and enable you to engage with users. So in that spirit, I'm just going to talk for 2 minutes on Google Now and Now API. For those of you, it did sound like there were a few iPhone users. Google Now is available on iPhone if you download the Google Search app. For those Android users, we also have, so Google Now is essentially Google's personal assistant. This is about us understanding context and providing predictive information to users. Is our kind of next bet in terms of the future of search. understanding context, providing predictive information to users. It's an incredibly difficult challenge, but we made some exciting announcements about partners that we've just started to enable to integrate into Google Now and provide their own cards, provide their own information. So, the fundamentals here are understanding context. So understanding that it's 3 o'clock, you're tired, and you want a coffee. Google can understand the specific time of the user. We can provide that context to partners, such as a cafe company, and those partners can push past users saying, hey, it's 3 o'clock with you, why don't you grab a coffee at the nearest coffee shop? If it's started to rain outside, and we know that the local time's 4 o'clock and you're likely to take a taxi, we can push your card to say, hey, why don't you take a taxi? And on Google's side, we have numerous different signals that we can provide around users' location, the time, the weather, what they're doing, so if you're starting your commute, for example. And we use these with partners to enable them to trigger cards for users. We've launched around 30, 40 partners in APAC with learning as we go, but we hope over time this will become an open API that we can work with you all on. And so here are 3 examples. I'm afraid they're quite US-centric. I should have pulled out some APAC ones. But these, so on the left-hand side we have Airbnb, understanding the context that maybe this is time-triggered, so it's on a Thursday, Airbnb want to push cards to people who are actively searching for holiday rentals. They can push a card to users recommending rentals in a similar search criteria that they've searched for previously. The second, one of the triggers we provide is around commutes, so we can say which users are actually on their daily commute, and Spotify can push a card to all those users who are on their daily commute saying, hey, why don't you listen to this playlist? And finally, taxi apps, so we have various different signals that we can provide to suggest that the user wants to take a taxi, and a taxi company can actively push a card to a user. Cool, so I'll hand back to Marita, who's just going to talk about how people are engaging with search through voice actions.
Okay,